Welcome to another episode of Fabric Tech Talk Fridays. Today I have here with me one other MVP from our MVP community, Kristyna Ferris, like the Ferris wheel. Kristyna, do you want to introduce yourself?
Yeah, so my name is Kristyna Ferris. I am a Microsoft MVP for both Microsoft Fabric and Data Platform. So I've been working with Power BI since it first came out and definitely a huge fan.
Wonderful. So before we get into all the goodness that we are sharing today, Kristyna, I want to, for our viewers, I just want to make sure, how did you start your MVP journey?
Yeah.
We want to get all the different versions of inspiration. So if you want to share your journey, please.
And there's so many. If you're wanting to be an MVP, there are a million ways to get there. It's not one path up the mountain. But for me, my dad actually used to be in the SQL community. And so he took us as kids to some of the presentations he did.
Wow.
And so later on, I kind of did not want to go down the data route. And then Power BI drew me back in. And once I started doing that, I just knew that I wanted to follow his footsteps and go into speaking and blogging. And that's what led me to become an MVP.
That's so personal. That's amazing. Because oftentimes, you know, we keep thinking that just tell the kids what to do.
Right.
But I think if you do it, it's just very natural for them to follow through.
Not only that, but they can see the path. It's not just in theory. It's not, oh, this should be good. It's, okay, here's what can actually come from it. And you see the fruits of that labor over years.
Oh, I love this story. Thank you for sharing that, Kristyna.
Yeah, of course.
So today, it's a very interesting topic, and I'm interested in learning more myself. It's the case, how case sensitivity and insensitivity really matters, and specifically in Fabric Data Warehouse.
Yes.
So tell us, why would it matter?
Yeah.
Does it really stick to data warehouse, or the case sensitivity or insensitivity is across the board, like lake houses, data warehouses, and beyond?
It's a great question. So inside of lake houses, those are going to be case sensitive. We're talking about warehouses in particular because we have an option to make them not case sensitive. So if you're not totally sure what I mean by case sensitive, case insensitive, typically what that is if I'm logging in and I write a query, and this is what I see a lot from business users, you know, you select and then you list your columns from a table. If you have a case-sensitive warehouse, you need to get every single uppercase letter correct in that statement. So, not a huge problem if you know this in advance, but let's say that you're trying to migrate. Maybe you have an on-prem data warehouse and you have a bunch of views already written. Those didn't used to have to be case-sensitive. And so when you transform them into Fabric, all of a sudden none of them work, because somebody somewhere decided they wanted to put an extra capital letter at the beginning of their table name.
Wow, that's huge.
It's huge.
No, I think you're unraveling something for, you know, many viewers for this, I guess.
Yeah.
So let's do a drill down on this, Kristyna. I'm excited to learn more, but also share more on this. Now, talking about sensitivities.
Yes.
Why would it matter from an organization perspective? Let's say I want to start my Fabric journey within my organization.
Yeah.
How do we, where do we go? What to do? Like, how do we, when we are modeling, I know data modeling is a first big step before you really start developing anything within the data world or the, you know, data life cycle.
Exactly.
When would you start thinking about this? How do you do it in Fabric? Why would it matter for organizations to think?
Yeah, so when you're planning your data estate, you want to think about who's using that data at every stage of the journey. So when you're starting out, you might not have a warehouse. You shouldn't have a warehouse as your bronze layer typically, right? If you're doing a medallion architecture, you want your raw data and something more flexible like a lakehouse. And something like a Spark notebook will interact with that really well. When you're talking about people who are going to be querying, right, maybe I'm building a net new report, or because Fabric is so easy to use, I can give this to a financial analyst, or I could give this to an operational analyst who might just know SQL.
Mm.
For them, they're not going to try and want to figure out what every single capitalization is. So it's really important to have naming conventions in general. But if you are, especially if you're moving something existing into Fabric and it is not net new, it is really important to consider that you need to know your case sensitivity options. And in Fabric, you have to set it up in advance.
Mm.
So if you've already built something, I have bad news for you. It is defaulted to be case sensitive. if you're building something new, follow what we're going to do. We're going to show you a couple ways. And Microsoft has recently made it even easier to make sure that when you're building things, it is automatically case insensitive.
Wonderful. Wonderful. Yeah. So that is good news.
Yes. Very good news.
Okay. But for existing data warehouses, which are set as case sensitive, for them to migrate to Microsoft Fabric, something to think about.
Yes.
Where would you go? And before you show us, I know we really want to see how all this comes to life,
yeah.
Kristyna. But before we get there, what is the difference between Fabric collation settings,
yes,
versus the traditional way of setting things for this?
So if you had a SQL server in the past, Azure SQL Server, on-prem SQL Server, either way, you were able to write a statement inside if you had the right permissions. Mm-hmm. Not everybody could do this.
100%.
But you could set the database collation with just a SQL script.
Mm-hmm.
So you could say, hey, set the collation to be case insensitive.
Mm-hmm.
You cannot do that via the SQL Analytics endpoint. You have to do it with the REST API.
Got it.
So the easy button that Microsoft has created, which I'm very excited about, is basically a workspace setting.
Wonderful.
And so the workspace setting, you can just set it there. But it's an interesting problem, right? Because we're used to working with servers and databases on our machines.
Mm-hmm.
This is a whole different ballgame. We're going to be doing this inside of a system that allows for a lot more complexity and a lot more scalability.
Mm-hmm.
So
mm-hmm.
REST APIs and workspace settings are your best friends.
Wonderful. I think I'm leaning more towards the workspace settings.
Me too. Yeah, I'm so excited about them. Yeah.
Perfect. Perfect. Yeah. Now, talking about this,
yeah.
I also want to bring the performance angle into the picture here, Kristyna. Are there any performance implications doing one way or the other?
They're so minute.
Mm.
They are so minute. The thing to consider is that at this point in your data estate, right, we're not talking about ingestion. We're not talking about taking things from just totally raw, unstructured data and putting them into something that kind of makes sense. We're talking about your gold layer.
Right.
We're talking about, hey, this is ready for somebody to report off of. I want somebody to connect to facts and dimensions. That's the level we're at.
Mm-hmm.
When you're there, your performance is going to be more about the query itself and less about the collation.
Got it.
Yep. So the query performance is going to be more dependent on how well you train your business users than on the actual.
And also, which modeling technique did you go with?
Yes.
Is it star schema? Is it snowflake?
Yeah.
And, you know, it gets into the whole rhythm of business that we need
to do. I think
we
might need to talk again. If we're going to go into those, but
more than welcome. Happy to do a whole new episode focused on that.
I would love it.
Perfect. So just to sort of reiterate,
yes,
there is performance implication, but it's not to the point where, oh my God, if you don't set this,
yeah,
it's going to bum your system. The query is going to take several minutes versus seconds. None of that.
We're talking milliseconds of difference.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah.
That's
it
to say.
Tiny.
Perfect.
Yeah.
Perfect.
Yeah.
Now, again, at Fabric Tech Talk Fridays, Kristyna,
yeah,
we want to get to the laptop and see what you got.
Oh, I'm so excited about this. So let me go ahead and get this turned on. It gets excited that I'm logging in. There we go. All right. So I'm going to show you the REST API version of this.
Okay.
Because the workspace version just got released.
Wonderful.
So it's going to have to be a little bit of a, you'll have to find it, but
sounds good.
We'll show the hard way and then you'll appreciate the easy way even more.
Yeah. Just draw the, you know, this bigger line in front of the smaller line or vice versa to make things easy.
Exactly.
Perspective.
It is. It's good for us. It's good for our souls.
Yeah.
All right. So we're going to talk about how to create a warehouse using the REST APIs. We're going to do two different ways. One of those ways is going to be actually via the Learn documentation.
Great.
So if you go to the Learn documentation and you look at the items, create warehouse, you can pop down to the examples and you'll see here we have a collation option. It's hidden in the examples. So a lot of people didn't even know you could do this because it's not listed as its own capability. It's also not listed as a limitation because you can do it.
Mm.
So we're going to go ahead and sign in. We've stolen this code segment that allows us to make a case insensitive warehouse. And once it signs in with my account, I'm going to go ahead and basically give it that body that we copied and pasted from the example. Then I'm going to grab my workspace ID. So I'm going to grab it from the URL. For those of you who don't know, you can always grab your workspace ID from the Fabric URL. And then I just pop it in there. It creates the postscript for me. It's also going to handle all of the authentication. So if you're just looking to make a one-off warehouse, this is typically what I would recommend. You just have to give it a name and then a description. I'm just calling this case insensitive fun. So that way when it pops up in my environment, I know exactly which one it is. And basically the key thing here is that collation type. So in the collation type, there's a underscore CI. That underscore CI means case insensitive.
Got it. Yep. So now the developer in me kicked in.
Yes.
A little bit.
Yeah.
So now you're talking about one-off. Let's say, because if you're looking at enterprises, you have several warehouses, so to speak.
You should, right?
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. So now what is the ideal way or the best practice in order to do that for multiple?
At a scalable level. In my opinion, notebooks. Notebooks are the way to go.
Okay.
Especially if you're doing a deployment pattern. So what I see a lot of people do is they will have a series of notebooks, maybe an orchestrator. And that orchestrator, I've seen this work really, really well, where you can have your set script for all of your different artifacts you know you're going to want. So if you're ingesting a new data source, for example, you might have a notebook that builds your lakehouse, your warehouse for your silver, gold, bronze. Maybe you have a standard set of silver transformations, so you put in a silver notebook that is standard. Mm-hmm. It's essentially an ARM template.
Got it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. If you're familiar with those basically can build up your environment from the ground up. It is really powerful.
Perfect.
We can do something similar with notebooks using the REST APIs.
Right.
So let's go ahead and see how that works.
Perfect.
Yeah, super fun. We have our case insensitive fun warehouse in there now. And then this is a notebook. I do have it in my GitHub as well. I'm happy to share it with folks. Mm-hmm. And essentially what it's going to do is it's going to find the workspace ID for me. I'm lazy in my notebooks. And if I'm deploying this, I don't want to change that variable all the time. So this will automatically figure out what workspace I'm in, apply that. And then it's going to use the MS Spark Utils notebook, and it's going to grab our token ID that way. So similar to how the website was doing our authentication when I clicked that button,
correct.
This is going to do the exact same thing behind the scenes.
Wonderful. Wonderful.
And then I'm going to give it a similar payload. I just gave it a different name, awesomeness, underscore awesomeness, because why not? And we got that 202 response. So I think we have our warehouse. Go ahead and refresh. And there it is. We now have two case insensitive warehouses.
Wonderful. Now, this is amazing. Now, as a takeaway, Kristyna, for people who are starting green, let's talk about two scenarios.
Yeah.
Existing data estate and net new. It's a green field. They're starting new.
I love that.
Plus one to that, especially anybody coming from legacy databases, data warehouses, net new and greenfield is like just such a breather.
I mean, they call it greenfield for a reason, right? It's like walking through a greenfield.
So tell me both the variations and the best practices for both.
No problem. So when you're talking about migration, the key thing with migration is the initial setup. So I think people overlook the fact that you have to put in certain configurations when you're migrating something because you think I already did the configurations. Right? I've already done that work. Why am I doing it again? It's because Fabric's different. Fabric's different than what you had before. So you need to tell it all the little quirks that you've already built into your old systems. So the best practice is going to be, in my opinion, to use something like the notebook.
Okay.
If you are using a net new workspace, use the workspace setting we talked about. If you toggle that on, it works like setting a server level collation. So in the back end, behind the scenes, what's happening with the SQL analytics endpoint, if you connect to that, you're actually connecting to the workspace as a server. And so your workspace is your server and your actual warehouse or your lakehouse is a database.
I love how you put it. The analogy is perfect to relate what we are trying to do in the Fabric settings. Perfect.
It makes such a difference to think about it that way. Yeah, so you're setting a server level. So if you set that up in the workspace, then you don't even have to worry about giving people a API. You don't have to worry about giving them a notebook. They can just, anytime they make a warehouse, it will automatically be in the correct collation.
Wonderful.
So
the GitHub repo will be available as a link in the description or on the screen. So please check that out. Now, thank you so much for educating us on the case sensitivities, what is the role that they play within the fabric ecosystem. Thank you so much for your time today, Kristyna. Appreciate it.
It was great. Thanks for having me.
Thank you, everyone, for watching. If you found this video valuable, don't forget, hit that like button.
If this is your first time visiting the Microsoft Fabric YouTube channel, be sure to smash that subscribe button.
Drop a comment below on what you'd like to see on future episodes of Fabric Tech Talk Fridays.
That's it for today. See you all next Friday for another deep dive into Microsoft Fabric.